So we originally released this video early January 2019, but after around 3 or 4 months, it actually got taken down by YouTube because one of the pieces of music used in there got flagged up for copyright. So we have done a completely new edit for you guys. Without further ado, let's get into it.
The 80s are back. So after rampaging through the 1970s, Queen were already considered rock royalty. And on June 30th, 1980, they unveiled their 8th studio album, The Game, which obviously featured their smash hit and bass guitar anthem, Another One Bites the Dust. He's a killer example of John Deacon's solid and inspirational bass playing, as well as his awesome songwriting as well. It soon got picked by some of the soul radio singers in America, but it was really Michael Jackson, a huge fan of the band, who suggested that they release it as a single, and obviously the rest is history. Now Deacon continued to introduce R&B elements to his bass lines, including the legendary collaboration with David Bowie from their 1982 album Hot Space, which obviously featured Under Pressure. Now, Bowie was probably one of the hippest guys alive on the planet at this point, and also responsible for several classics during his funk period. Ashes to Ashes, the lead single obviously from the 1980s, Scary Monster is one such tune and features the awesome bass playing of George Murray. And let's not forget the 1983 Let's Dance with Carmine Rojas on bass. Okay, so he's here. You called me out last time for not adding him in the 1970s, but with the clean production, tighter songwriting, and excellent tunes, 1980s Moving Pictures is a fast-track way of getting your head around Geddy Lee's awesome bass playing with Rush. The instrumental YYZ is a great place to start, with Geddy and drummer, obviously Neil Peart, trading solo licks, but the bass tone throughout is absolutely killer. A long-time user of a Ricky 4001, Geddy was also dabbling with a Wall at that time and Steinberger basses as well, all while singing too. He can sing and play bass like that. Alien. In 1981, the band released Exit Stage Left, a live album recorded on tour that followed Moving Pictures. Geddy is as prominent as ever, punching through the notes at a ridiculous pace on that album. Maybe that's why they called it Rush. I don't know. Now, 1980 was also a vintage year for hard rock and metal, and it doesn't get much heavier than the next bassist. I bet you can all guess who it is. The famously hard-living lead singer of Motörhead. Now, Lemmy's legend is somewhat automatic just for sticking it out and rocking so hard for so damn long. He took copious amounts of LSD as a roadie for Jimi Hendrix in the late 60s and 1970s, and then as a bass player with the band Hawkwind, who actually fired him in 1975 after he was arrested for drug possession on the Canadian border. Lemmy's response was to form Motörhead. Now, the band's golden era was really, I would say, 1979 to 1983, which really peaked with their most successful studio album, Ace of Spades, in 1980, and their first live album, No Sleep Till Hammersmith, a year later. Now, Lemmy's bass style was also pretty unique as well, combining chords with a super heavily distorted Rickenbacker tone. His amp was a customised 1976 Marshall super bass known as Murder One. Now, Lemmy once said that he set the bass on 0, treble on 0, and his mids on 10. Who knows if that was actually true, but that's what was said. He used a Marshall 1970L 4x15 cabinet and had as many on stage as physically possible. It is easy to see why Motörhead had the title of the loudest band in the world. Now, for many, thrash metal didn't really exist until the formation of Metallica in 1981. Heavily indebted to Motörhead, a brief shuffling of personnel produced the first solid lineup, which was James Hetfield on guitar and vocals, Lars Ulrich on drums, and Kirk Hammett on guitar, and the legendary, obviously you guys know this, Cliff Burton on bass. This period produced some outstanding work, including Kill 'Em All, Ride the Lightning, and in particular 1986's Master of Puppets, one of the best albums of all time. But ultimately, Cliff's time was cut short when the band's tour bus crashed in Sweden and he was tragically killed. Now, obviously, Cliff was no easy act to follow, and Jason Newsted was given the job just 3 weeks after Cliff's death. But even on the band's notoriously bass-deprived 1988 album, And Justice For All, Newsted still managed some significant contributions. Check out To Live Is To Die, which sees Newsted playing some assorted bass parts left unfinished by Cliff and sculpting them into a ultra-heavy tribute. Now, while Metallica were on their way to taking over the world and becoming one of the biggest acts ever, Iron Maiden's full-length live album, 1985, Live After Death, captured the band at their globe-spanning peak. Some might say, really, that Iron Maiden's entire career had been built around the galloping style of bassist Steve Harris. That man has a right forearm made of iron. Now, anyone who's tried this technique for any length of time will testify to how difficult it actually is. Check out Rime of the Ancient Mariner, which has to be the pinnacle of that album. At the time when synth bass ruled, Duran Duran were describing themselves as a cross between the Sex Pistols and Chic, and playing rock music with a very, very groovy low end. Their 1982 album Rio featured some huge, huge hits. Obviously, Hungry Like a Wolf, Save a Prayer, and some killing bass lines as well, not least the title track, Rio. Just like that, river twisting, moved us. To be fair, there was an enormous variety of genres for any music fan in the 1980s. Remember that this was the time when the synth keyboards ruled, when computerized sequencers were rapidly making ground and bass players feared for their jobs.
I'll outplay anybody using the machine, or I'll die. The day that the machine outplays me, they can plant me in the yard with the corn. And I mean it.
So retaliation from us guys came mainly with the five-string bass. A low B on the bass guitar allowed bassists to match the low C on the synth, which previously went right underneath the low E on a four-string bass. Jimmy Johnson, killing bass player by the way, was among the first to use a five-string bass with the low B on the Los Angeles session scene, popularising the instrument with his forward-leaning fusion on the Alan Holdsworth's 1984 album Tokyo Dream. Well, the golden age of the session scene was really, you know, may have come and gone by the 1980s. There was still a select group of studio bass players who were advancing the tradition of their predecessors. Donald Fagen's 1982 album, The Night Flight, is a classic example of this. This was Donald Fagen's solo debut, following his split from Steely Dan partner Walter Becker, and brought together a collection of musicians that read like the who's who of top session guys. Anthony Jackson was on this album and shared bass usage with Abe Laboriel, Will Lee, Marcus Miller and Chuck Rainey, all given a masterclass in bass playing on that album. There's some tasty synth bass as well from Greg Fillinganes too that you need to check out. The songs are great and every track is a pure joy to listen to. Now, another landmark studio album from the early 80s is Toto 4, which was released in the spring of 1982 and received no less than 6 Grammy Awards a year later. With the original bass player of Toto, David Hungate, moving to Nashville during the recording of the album to spend more time with his family, this was the final album with the original Toto lineup. It's worth mentioning as well that all the band members were regular session greats as well, and the band actually delayed touring that album because they were involved with the production of Michael Jackson's Thriller, which brings me on nicely to my next pick, Thunder Thumbs himself, Lewis Johnson. So having found fame in the 1970s with Brother Johnson, Lewis Johnson left an imprint on the bass world which was obviously unforgettable. The most enduring hit was probably Stomp from the Brothers' 1980 album Light Up the Night, but Quincy Jones, who became their manager, also collaborated with them on several key recordings, including The Dude. Any Big Lebowski fans out there? In 1981, before laying the foundation for what would become the biggest selling album of all time, Michael Jackson's Thriller in 1982. After Thriller, Johnson was constantly in demand as a session musician, and his slap bass lines can be heard on Matt all over the place, like Time Exposure by Sandy Clark, Hydra by Grover Washington Jr., Thief in the Night by George Duke, and obviously also check out his bass line for Michael McDonald's hit I Keep Forgetting Every Time You're Near. Johnson played with such power that he regularly blew his bass amp speakers, and alongside Larry Graham, he remains the godfather of slap bass. Meanwhile, a giant of British bass playing, Mark King, was also paving the way for slap bass in the mainstream 80s pop. Listen to Level 42 tracks like Hot Water, and obviously, I know you are thinking this, Love Games. The group notched up 20 UK top 40 hits throughout the 1980s, but it was an appearance on Top of the Pops playing the Chinese Way from their 1985 album Pursuit of Accidents that really sparked an interest in Mark King. Obviously, his slap technique is phenomenal. But whether he's playing slap or fingerstyle, everyone wanted to capture a little of Mark's magic. Over the years, he's been responsible for the sale of lorry loads of JDs, Alembics, and Status graphite headless basses as well. Now, synths and drum machines might have dominated pop music in the early 80s, but in Jaco Pastorius' wake came some killing fretless bass players too. Pino Palladino's breathtaking counterpoint on Paul Young's No Parlay album has kept tracks like Every Time You Go Away oozing out of radio speakers ever since 1984. Now, obviously, Japan were another breath of fresh air, and a lot of credit for their distinct sound should definitely go to the bassist Mick Kahn. He was completely original in his approach and his sound, thanks to the trademark tone of his fretless wall bass. Tin Drum from 1981 is probably the band's finest hour, featuring some classic bass parts on songs like Cantonese Boy and Sons of Pioneers, as well as the haunting hit single Ghosts. Now, elsewhere, Tony Levin's innovations with King Crimson and Peter Gabriel resulted in sounds that had really never been heard on the bass. Take his fretless work on Peter Gabriel's Sledgehammer or his wooden funk fingers on the smash it Big Time in 1986. And then there's his bass playing on King Crimson's Discipline album in 1981. Now, that album opened my eyes and ears to a whole new world of bass playing. Now, while we're on the subject of fretless bass, I need to mention, obviously, Paul Simon's 1986 album Graceland, which featured a killing bass lineup, including Paul Simon himself on six-string bass. There are so many amazing tracks to talk about here. Boy in the Bubble, Diamonds on the Soles of Her Shoes, Graceland, obviously, and, of course, the fretless extravaganza on You Can Call Me Out, with Chevy Chase in the music video as well. Can you get any better than that? Now, the amazing bass break played by Bikithi Kamalo stunned everyone, although there was more than a little manipulation in the production being heavily compressed and obviously played backwards in parts. Now, they actually recorded that track on Bikithi's birthday, and as a little gift, Paul gave him free rein over what to play in that part. He came up with the part and took it down in one take, but the gag is that the second bar of that solo is actually just the first bar reversed. It's all in the production. Engineer Roy Haley simply flipped the tape over and spliced the two parts together, so it is actually physically impossible to play that part correctly. Now, probably best known for his work with the band Living Colour, Doug Wimbish can also look back on an esteemed career that started back in the day with Sugar Hill Records in the early 80s. Along with guitarist Skip McDonald and drummer Keith LeBlanc, Wimbish went on to play on some of the biggest hip-hop anthems of the time, including White Lines, Don't Do It, That's the Joint, and Apache. A master of bass effects, Doug has also enjoyed an impressive career as a sideman for the likes of Jeff Beck, Mick Jagger, Mos Def, Carly Simon, Seal, and Madonna. You should also check out Doug's work with Living Colour drummer Will Cahoon as well, as drum and bass act Jungle Funk. Now, along with drummer Sly Dunbar, Robbie Shakespeare transformed funk reggae bass into an art form and proved just how energizing reggae bass can actually be, even in the digital era. Together, Sly and Robbie have played on thousands and thousands of recordings, and not just with reggae artists. His Fender, Hofner Steinberger, and Paul Reed Smith basses, always strung with flats, by the way, have done wonders for Grace Jones, Bob Dylan, Paul McCartney, Sinead O'Connor, and a ton of others too. Just grab Nightclubbing by Grace Jones or the Black Uhuru Anthology by Island Records. You'll find out what I mean. Now, to wrap up the 1980s, I want to pay tribute to three amazing bass players who I actually remember seeing on stage together as the supergroup B3 back in 2006, 2007? You guys will probably know. Let me know in the comments when those guys were playing together. And obviously, I'm talking about Stu Hamm, Jeff Berlin, and the amazing Billy Sheehan. Billy's in-your-face bass style has been forged over a lifetime spent redefining heavy rock. From his early band Talis to stints with Steve Vai, Dave Lee Roth, and Niacin to several years on top of the world with Mr. Big. But it's his bass work on one of my favourite albums of all time, Dave Lee Roth's 1986 solo album, Eat 'em and Smile, that first got my attention. Now, also in 1986, the monstrous bass player Jeff Berlin released an amazing solo album called Pump It, which showcased his melodic support and solo style, which he was world renowned for, boasting some of the most virtuosic bass chops I have ever heard in my life. Jeff Berlin is a bass player with plenty to say about life and the low end. His career covers some 40 years of music making, including top sideman jobs with the likes of Bill Bruford, Scott Henderson, as well as some amazing solo albums as well. Now, last but by no means least, we have Stu Hamm. And he's enjoyed a lengthy career as a sideman with guitarist Joe Satriani and Steve Vai, who I can remember watching Stu Hamm when I was like 13. Watching Joe Satriani, I was like, oh, Joe. You should absolutely check out Stu's solo albums. Kings of Sleep, released in 1989, is a great place to check out his mesmerizing fretwork, which is largely responsible for bringing tapping into the bass world. He really was a game changer. So there you have it, guys. That was bass in the 1980s. I'm sure I've missed some people out, but remember, the 1990s is coming, so they might be getting added to the 1990s, or they might be in the 1970s video that we released just a few weeks ago. What I'll do is put a link in the description to the 1970s videos, the 1935 videos, never burp on camera, and I'll also link as well to the free Scots Bass Sessions Toolkit, which is an amazing resource of videos telling you how to get a killer bass tone, how to set up your bass. I interview an amazing luthier about body woods and neck woods and how that all comes into play. We've got a workshop on how to use the modes to create bass lines and all of that cool stuff. I'll put a link below to that. All you need to do is hit the link and then you can hook yourself up with it completely free. Now, without further ado, obviously, as always, take it easy and I'll see you in the shed.